reason being, the word is the instrument that the Spirit uses to convert the souls of men. In the sixth chapter of the book of Ephesians, the Apostle Paul writes, as he is writing about the different parts of the Christian armor, writes of the fact that the sword of the Spirit is the word of God. It is his instrument. It is the means that he uses to bring about the salvation of a person. In James chapter 1, in verse 21, James said, "Receive with meekness the engrafted or implanted word, which is able to save your souls." Paul wrote to the Romans in Romans chapter 1 and verse 16. He said, "I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek." And so the word of God is the power that God uses to bring about the salvation of an individual. But we need to understand, though, that it is so very important how an individual views the word, which, of course, ultimately would lead to his conversion. It's important, then, how he views it, how he approaches the word, how he handles the word, and what his general overall attitude is toward the word of God. That's also very, very important to us as Christians, because although James writes that it is the implanted word that is able to save the soul, those words were also written in Christians. And so there's the need for us, not only when we initially obey the gospel to obtain salvation, there's the need for us to remain in a saved condition. And if we remain in a saved condition, it will continue to be because of our attitude toward the word, and because of how we approach it, how we handle it, and its place in our lives. And so, what we're going to do for the next few moments is look at an example in the book of Acts of the conversion of an individual. There's so much we can learn, because eight times, and this is very, very significant, eight times in this text, there's an emphasis upon the word of God. Eight times. That tells us something about the importance of the word in the conversion of this individual. And so there's a great deal that we can learn from that. We're going to be considering then the eunuch, the Ethiopian eunuch, and the word of God. First of all, we begin by looking at his association with the word of God. His association with the word of God. As Philip joins himself to the chariot of this Ethiopian nobleman, what do you suppose that Philip is going to be talking with him about? What are they going to be discussing? Would it be his relationship as an employee of the queen of Ethiopia? He was her treasurer. He had a very important position in that kingdom, and so that certainly could very well have been a topic of discussion, but it wasn't. Was Philip going to discuss different aspects of his job, and perhaps the different places that his job would take him? That could have been an interesting topic as well, but that was not what they discussed. What about his wealth? And there's every reason to believe that this man was a wealthy man because of the particular position that he occupied, because of the job that he held. That also could have been something that would have been very interesting to discuss, but it was not the topic of discussion on this day. The question is, what was this Ethiopian eunuch doing? His association with various and sundry things could have been looked at. His association with the queen, his association with his job in particular, and in a broad way. But what was he doing when Philip joined himself to the chariot? You and I know the answer to that. He was reading from the word of God. He was reading from the 53rd chapter of the book of Isaiah, which of course contained the prophecies of the Messiah. And even more specifically, that particular chapter contained the prophecies dealing with the crucifixion of the Son of God. And Isaiah, 700 years before the event took place, wrote in detail about the crucifixion of Christ. And so that's what the eunuch was doing. He was reading from the Word of God. Now, just the fact that as you look at the account, starting in verse 26 of Acts chapter 8, and you continue reading down through the text, let me tell you something. You don't have to read very far before you come to the conclusion this man's traveling companion was the Word of God. Apparently, he wouldn't leave home without it. Now, if we were to make a present-day application, how important is the Word to us? When we go on trips, maybe we go on vacations, and perhaps we go to other places from time to time. Even some of our jobs may take us to different places. The Word of God should be a traveling companion. We should not leave home without it. And the fact that this man was reading from the Word of God as he was traveling tells us something about his association with the Word. It tells us he loved the Word of God. He appreciated the Word of God. He held the Word of God to a great, great standard as far as value is concerned. It was very important to him. He was much like the psalmist of whom we read, or the blessed man rather, of whom we read in Psalm 1 and verse 2, where it says that his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law that he meditate day and night. That sounds like the unit. That sounds like, that helps you to, enables us to have the idea that he spent a great deal of time in the Word of God. David said, "Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against thee." Psalm 119 and verse 11. And in verse 105, he said, "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet, and a light into my path." All of these verses point to one conclusion, and that is the importance and the value and the place that the Word of God should hold in our lives. And that's the place that it held in this man's life. He had a very close association with the Word of God in that he read it, and the implication is that he read it a great deal. And then secondly, let's look at his attitude, his overall attitude toward the Word of God. First of all, it ought to be respected. The Word of God ought to be respected. Now, we can take this in so many different directions as far as having proper respect for the Word of God. But let's look very briefly at this man in particular. Why had he been to Jerusalem? Why had he come to Jerusalem? Well, the text says that he had come to Jerusalem to worship. He had come to Jerusalem to worship God. Now we know that since at this point in time he was not a New Testament Christian, then he could not properly engage in New Testament worship, because that is one of the blessings that is reserved for a Christian. But here's the point. He came to Jerusalem to worship because he respected the Scripture. Now, let me tell you this. You take an individual who truly respects the Word of God. I'm talking about a member of the church now. You take one who truly respects the Word of God, you won't have to beg that Christian, that member of the church, to attend the services of the church. You won't have to beg them to come to worship on Sunday morning, Sunday night, and then again on Wednesday night. Now, there would be, no doubt, a multiplicity of reasons for that. But one of those reasons, no doubt, would be the respect that they hold for the Word of God. Now, again, as I said, you could take it in a lot of different directions. If we truly respect the Word of God, then we'll worship in the way that God wants us to worship. As far as the regularity of worship, as we said a moment ago, You won't have to beg this person to attend worship. You won't have to beg this person to be involved in the work of the church if they truly respect the Word of God. And as far as the general overall conduct of a child of God, you won't have to beg them to live a Christian life if they respect the Scriptures. And so, first of all, we see then that this Ethiopian eunuch respected the Word of God. But then, secondly, he understood that the Word needed to be read. It needed to be read. As a matter of fact, that's what he was doing. He was returning and sitting in his chariot, and he was reading Isaiah the prophet. He was reading. This tells us that he understood that what he was reading was very important to him and should be important to him. Important to the degree that he was going to spend time reading about it. And in this particular instance, and we'll talk more about this in just a moment, he didn't understand everything that he was reading, but he was still going to spend time reading from the Word of God. Let's look at verse 30. Philip ran thither to him and heard him read the prophet Isaiah, and said, "Understandest thou what thou readest?" So he was reading from the prophet Isaiah. He was reading Isaiah 53, and Philip asked him the question, "Do you understand what you are reading?" Now, obviously, there were some problems here as far as his complete understanding, because he asked Philip the question, "How can I, except some man should guide me?" Let me tell you something. That question tells us even more about the Ethiopian eunuch. That tells us that he didn't think that he had all the answers. He didn't have the idea that I don't need anyone telling me what the Word of God or what the Scriptures have to say. He also understood that as long as I continue reading the Scriptures, I'm going to come across some things that I simply do not understand. But I need some help. I need someone to guide me in understanding the Scriptures. So he understood then that he did not have all the answers. In Acts chapter 8 and verse 32, Luke says the place of the Scripture which he read was this. So you see, when you look at this text over and over again, he was reading. He was reading. He was reading at this place. And so you have an emphasis then upon reading the Word of God. And the Bible, over and over again, emphasizes the importance and the necessity of reading. Look at Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 11. "When all Israel is come to appear before the Lord thy God in the place which he shall choose, thou shalt read this law before all Israel in their hearing. Thou shalt read it." In 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 13, Paul wrote to the young preacher Timothy, telling him, "Till I come, give attendance to reading, to exhortation, to doctrine." And so here Paul was instructing Timothy, you need to spend some time reading from the Scriptures. Because the words of the Lord in John chapter 10, or John chapter 6 rather, "The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit, they are life," they're life-giving. And so for that reason, we need to spend time reading from the Scriptures. But Jesus himself even emphasized the reading of the Scriptures. In Matthew 12 and verse 3, to the religious leaders, Jesus asked them, "Have ye not read what David did?" And then in Matthew 21 and verse 16, he said to him, "Hearest thou not what these say?" And Jesus saith unto him, "Yea, have ye never read?" And so, again, there's an emphasis upon reading. And we can look at other examples, even from the Lord, in continuing to give these examples of him emphasizing the need to read from the Word of God. But then thirdly, let's look at his approach to the Word of God. First of all, he was going to approach the Word confidently. He was going to approach it confidently. He was confident that he could understand it. He was confident that he could understand it. One of the things that we oftentimes hear today in the religious world is that the idea is that it is impossible for everyone to understand the scriptures alike. Now, the problem with that is it's simply not the case. It's simply not true. Because it is possible for everyone to understand the scriptures alike. What do you have to do? Well, first and foremost, you've got to lay aside all preconceived ideas. You have to lay aside tradition. You have to lay aside opinions. Everything that is contrary to the Word of God, put it aside, and then simply read the Scriptures to see what they have to say and to see what God wants us to know and what God wants us to do. Listen to Paul in Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 4. Whereby, when ye read, ye may understand my knowledge and the mystery of Christ. Paul, did you say we can understand it? Absolutely. Well, what do I have to do to understand it? Read it. That's that simple. It really is that simple. Just simply read it. And so the Ethiopian eunuch then approached it confidently. He was confident. He was confident that it was the Word of God. It reminds us of the Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 13. When Paul was writing to them, he commended them because when he came to them, preaching to them the Word of God, he said, ye received it as it is in truth, the Word of God. They didn't receive it as the Word of men. They didn't receive it as tradition. They didn't receive it as the opinions of men. They received it as the Word of God. And that was the view that the Ethiopian eunuch had of the Word, that it was in fact the Word of God. But then he also would approach it carefully. He would approach it carefully. He didn't want to misapply it. And that's why he asked the question there in the text, how can I understand this except some man should guide me? Now he's reading about Christ. And he's reading about the fact that as he was being led to the crucifixion, that he didn't defend himself. He opened not his mouth. So he didn't want to misinterpret that. He didn't want to misapply. He wanted to make sure that he understood exactly what the great prophet of God was saying. And so he asked, how can I except someone should guide me? So he wanted to make sure then that he did not misapply and that he did not misinterpret what the prophet was saying. That's very important because there are so many times today when people do misapply the scriptures today. For example, in John chapter 15, when Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches, there are many people today who have the idea that the branches that Jesus was speaking of were the different sectarian groups or the different denominations that are in existence today. That's a misinterpretation of the Scripture. And when you look at the text, it becomes clear that that's not what Jesus is talking about. The individual disciples of Christ were the branches that he was speaking of. And there's so many other examples that we could look to as well where people misapply and misinterpret the different scriptures as far as the Word of God is concerned. So he was very careful in his approach to the Word of God. In 2 Timothy 2 and verse 15, Paul says, study or give diligence to show thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing, the American Standard of Belief says, handling aright. Handle it correctly. Handle it carefully. And that's so very, very important. But then, what about his application of the Word of God? He applied it. First of all, he applied it personally. The question in his mind was not what anyone else, and we know that this particular spot wasn't anyone else around, but he wasn't concerned with what others might say. And when he got back to Ethiopia, and when he returned to the queen to fulfill other duties of his position, he wasn't concerned even about what she was going to think about what he did. So So first of all, then, he was going to apply personally. What doth hinder me? What do I need to do? What do I need to do? And that tells us then, first of all, he had a willing mind. He didn't have his mind made up because of some preconceived idea. Prejudice was not involved in his attitude toward the Scriptures. He simply applied it personally to himself. But then he also was going to apply it promptly. He didn't delay. He is ready to obey the gospel, and he's ready to do it now. Look at this. They're riding along, they're studying. And Philip begins from that scripture that he's studying there in Isaiah 53, and he preaches to him about Christ. Now, what does he preach about as far as Jesus is concerned? Well, since at this point in time, the fullness of the gospel involves the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord, and since Jesus died so that man could be saved, no doubt the crucifixion of the Son of God was one of the things, the central thing that Philip taught him about. The crucifixion of Christ and the resurrection of Christ, because Paul writes in Romans 1 and verse 4 that Jesus was declared to be the Son of God with power of the resurrection from the dead. Well, if he taught him about the death, the burial, the resurrection of the Lord, 1 Corinthians 15, 1 through 4, then obviously he also had to say something about baptism. Because it is through the action of baptism that one obtains the remission of sins. And we find from Romans 6, verses 1 through 6, that obedience to the gospel is a pattern or a likeness of the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord. One dies to the practice of sin, the Bible calls it repentance. He is buried in the watery grave of baptism, buried with Christ in baptism, Romans 6 and verse 3. He is raised to 3 and 4. He is raised to walk in newness of life, Romans 6 and verse 4. So, Philip had to have taught him about that. And so when we understand that, we also understand then that as they're riding along, and the eunuch sees this body of water, he says, see, or look. Look, here's water. What doth hinder me to be baptized? And Philip says, if you believe with all of your heart, you may. So is there anything that is hindering you from obedience to the gospel? In effect, the eunuch says, no. I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. So what does he do? Promptly, he obeys the gospel. Immediately, Philip commands that the chariot stand still. They go down into the water, both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptizes him. Now is the accepted time. Today is the day of salvation. We read in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, in verse 2. And so because of that, and because of the urgency of salvation, why should he delay? He shouldn't. He did exactly what he should have done. These are some of the great lessons that we learn from looking at the conversion of the Ethiopian eunuch. And again, in this, we see his association with the Word of God, is that his overall attitude toward the Scriptures, and the fact that he knows that it's his responsibility to obey implicitly. He knows that it is his responsibility to do so immediately. That's the attitude that he had for the Word of God. And the attitude that you and I are to have for the Scriptures should be no less than what he had. Because although we become New Testament Christians by obeying the gospel of Christ, it is still the Word of God that governs our lives. That fact alone tells something about the importance of it and the value of it. Sometimes we sing the song, Give Me the Bible. There's so many other songs that emphasize the importance of the Word of God and the place that it should have in our lives and the fact that we're to follow it and obey it and the attitude, the overall attitude that we're to have because of the fact that it governs every single aspect of the life that we live as Christians. You're here this evening. not a Christian, we encourage you to obey the gospel. Peter instructed those on Pentecost in Acts 2:38, repent and be baptized for the remission of sins. If you're an erring child of God, then return to your first love through repentance and prayer.